Shalom to all the brothers and sisters worldwide. I want to say shalom this Sabbath. I thought that we would go into a detailed lesson, not a long lesson, but a detailed lesson today on the Bible controversy. Now, we're calling this the Bible controversy based on the fact that there's an influx, an innumerable number of people who once operated with the Bible, mainly the poor, mainly the children of slaves, that have begun to leave the Bible and go into other ideologies outside of the Bible. So the question is why? Is it because the slaves have educated themselves and came to a degree to realize that there was something greater than the book, the Bible? I also noticed that the majority of children of slaves, which is the children of Israel, and we're going to go into that in a moment, who decide not to deal with the Bible, didn't feel that way at one point. And until it seems like when the oppressor or the master was dealing with the Bible, then everyone out there was following the Bible. Now that we have come into a New Age movement, which the Gentiles, the Grecians, the Romans call the Age of Aquarius, it seems as if the master that once, quote unquote, so-called follow the Bible, have now morphed into a New Age, all-inclusive, universal embodiment of spirit in which every individual believe they are powerful and are God and have no need for the Bible. Now, it wasn't like this before. No matter what Massa would tell us, no matter what the others would tell us, we would stay firm on the Bible. You're going to find out today, brothers and sisters, that it's no coincidence. This is no coincidence that the people who once depended on the Bible have now left the scriptures. This was meticulously orchestrated by the Roman Catholic Church, the Jesuits. They never intended on having the whole world follow the Bible. They were utilizing the Bible for a time, understanding that it was the book, the book of liberation for the children of God. So they used the book for a time. They studied the book for a time and became the authorities of the book while we were asleep, while we served captivity. Once we began to understand that our character and our plight was actually contained in the Bible, and that Christ and the disciples and all the characters in the Bible relates to us, then there was a paradigm shift in which now the Bible is being questioned worldwide, whether or not it's authentic. When we understood nothing at all, everyone wanted us to go into the Bible, or every religion was shaped for us to go into the Bible because we believed at that time that, according to them, they were the people of the Bible. But now, since we have found out we're the children of Israel, there's been a paradigm shift in which everyone is going into something else. Now, here's another phenomenon that I'm seeing that I thought I would never see. I see people who understood, according to the prophecies of the Bible, that they were the children of Israel and are the children of Israel. And we're going to go into it in a moment. The Bible is the only book that shows, give you the story of why we went into captivity. It gives us a story of the other nations preying on us while we're being scattered throughout the four corners of the earth, and how we will one day come together as a people under the true God. The Bible gives us this information. But we have people now who understood the prophecies, was perplexed, and they actually was happy when they realized that slavery and all the things contained concerned in our particular situation was actually written in the same book. They felt free. They felt alive. They felt liberated that the Most High had finally showed them their true direction, opposed to the false history that had been out there. And they cleave to the Bible, but something happened. You have some people who once believed they were Israel going into something else outside the Bible. So we're not here to attack anyone. What we're here to do is to show you the reason. The reason there's a Bible controversy. I noticed that when it comes to the Bible controversies, it's usually, the Bible is tampered with. Usually you hear this from, I can give you a long list of people, long list of groups. Let's use Muslims for an example. A Muslim will go into the Bible all day long with you, as long as they can show you their interpretation of it. No sooner as you show them out of the Bible that the Bible condemns following a rock. Let's get that real quick. I'm just going to give you some examples. No sooner as you find in the book that the prophet that it's spoken of in Deuteronomy have nothing to do with Muhammad, it has everything to do with Christ, that's when another spin comes out and they start claiming the Bible is tampered with. But it wasn't tampered with when you ran into me as an ignorant child of a slave with no knowledge of the Bible. You used the Bible to pull me into Islam by claiming, you follow the Bible? Well, that's fine. Do you know Muhammad is the prophet that was prophesied in the Bible? Do you know that Allah is the God of the Bible, and that Christ, I respect Christ, but he's a prophet, so was Muhammad? See, this is how they slowly but surely deceive you into following something else, by first agreeing with your foundation. That's a tactic they use. But their horns come out, and that's not a metaphor. Their horns come out, brothers and sisters, once you go into the Bible and discredit their deception. And the first thing we deal with in Bible controversy is, well, who wrote the Bible? The Bible is tampered with. I'm just using the Muslims as an example because that same train of thought goes into everyone or every religion and every group that claim the Bible is tampered with. They will deal with the Bible as long as they can pull out their ideology and use certain precepts to back their way of thinking. But the Bible, I'm going to show you today, was not supposed to be used like that. They're not rightly dividing the word. They're picking and choosing words and verses to back their own ideology. And you can't. Why? Because this book is a book of Hebrews. This book is a book of Israelites. So how can you give a perspective outside of Israel using the Bible and not understand the Bible's instructions, the Bible's purpose concerning the people in the Bible? So you can't rightly divide the word in any ideology unless you understand why the Bible is given. And that's what we're going to go into today. I'm going to show you a short example using Islam first. Read what it says about a rock.
This is Leviticus chapter 26, verse 1.
Leviticus 26, verse 1, and that makes sure you give me the one in name also.
Yes, sir. You shall not make any idols, nor graven image, neither rear you up a standing image.
Read it again.
You shall not make you no idols.
You cannot make any idols. You can't rear up a graven image. That's against the God of the Bible. So, of course, every religion, including Islam, have some principles. Moral principles also, but they feel it's a problem when you start pulling out what's wrong with their religion in the Bible, the idolatry that they deal with, that the children of Israel was to shun from, and their evil practices, their ceremonies, their rituals, that all leads to gods outside of the God of the Bible. So if you see anyone rearing up a statue in a rock or an altar in something outside of the Most High, you know that they have went off the path. Read.
Leviticus 26 and 1.
Read it.
You shall not make no idols.
You shall not make no idols.
Nor graven image.
Nor graven images.
Neither rear you up a standing image.
Neither rear you up a standing image.
Neither shall you set up any image of stone.
Neither shall you do what?
Set up any image of stone.
So why didn't a Muslim pull that out of the Bible when they claimed that they were following the Bible? When they claimed that Muhammad was written of in the Bible. Why didn't they pull out that scripture? That you shouldn't rear up a stone. You know why? Because they're dealing with the Kaaba stone in Mecca, which is a demon that's embodied within that particular shrine. That all the people that follow that religion get their source of power from and get their blessings, quote unquote blessings from. That's not the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible would not tell you to not rear up a rock to worship it. He wouldn't tell you that. He's telling you straight not to do so. See that? So if he's telling you not to do so, who is the God of the rock? Satan. See? I'm just giving you some examples. Let's get the one straight and name him. Give me an example. So the God of the Bible, it's not the God of the Muslims, regardless of what they claim. And I'm giving you an example because they all come with Bible controversy to first get you out of the Bible to show you what they want to introduce. Why? And normally, everyone that's against the Bible, that has some controversy concerning the Bible, does the same thing. They'll go into the Bible and say, well, read that. Do you agree with that? But they're looking at it from a different perspective. Mm-hmm. Like, I agree with that because that leads me to this outside the Bible, which I see is greater, more grand, more bigger, better. If you're not going to deal with the Bible, don't deal with it at all. Don't use it as a deception to come to someone claiming you follow the Bible, knowing you have a direction. Bring your intent and direction first. But Satan won't do that. He operates in the dark. And preys on the ignorant. Let's give another example. Read that in Nahum. Habakkuk.
Habakkuk chapter 2, 18 through 19. What profiteth the graven image?
What profiteth is the graven image?
That the maker thereof hath graven it.
Go ahead.
The molten image.
The molten image.
And a teacher of lies.
So there's a molten image because we understand that there's also gold and different layers of metals enshrined with these idols. Not only is it an idol, it's a what?
A teacher of lies.
It's a teacher of lies. So whatever philosophy come with that rock, come with that disobedient erection of an idol, whatever doctrine comes with it is a lie. Even when they claim they're bringing forth the Bible. Why? Because they are not rightly dividing the word of truth. They're leading us into a book or into an ideology outside of the purpose that's contained within the Bible. And I'll tell you what, I'm used to dealing with it so much that it's the same pattern no matter what religion it is that has controversy against the Bible. Whether you deal with Black Africanism, whether you deal with Buddhist, whether you deal, no matter what it is, they all have the same philosophy. Like an Egyptologist, which were on our show the other day. He go to every scripture that say amen in there, trying to relate it to Amun Ra. So to the ignorant, somebody that came out of the church that haven't studied the Bible from a scholastic or a scholarly level, they would run into an Egyptologist just talking and listening to him talk. And then he'll take you to all these scriptures that say amen in the back. Say, there's Amun Ra. Did you know that? And a Christian, which haven't studied the Bible, will look at it and be like, man, that's deep. Amun Ra. Not understanding that amen only means so be it in the Hebrew. So they'll begin to have their eyes open and their ears open. Excuse me, their eyes open and their ears open to this new philosophy, thinking that the Bible led them there. See? On and on and on and on and on and on. Every religion does this. Why? This was a plan, like I said from the beginning, from the Jesuits. Now, in order to understand and tear down the controversy, one must first know what is the purpose of the Bible. Because if you go into the purpose of the Bible, no one can dispute that. It doesn't matter what religion or ideology you're dealing with. You cannot dispute the purpose of the Bible. The instructions of the Bible, you cannot dispute. You can probably say, well, some of those instructions are someplace else. Or the same information is older. Doesn't matter how old it is or how new it is. The fact that the instructions cannot be denied, that the instructions and intent is what we should apply to our lives. That's the key, and no one can deny it. But the Bible has a certain exclusivity that all other religions don't want to accept. When I say that, they would like to cleave to the Bible but ignore God's people. And see, and that's why in the New Age, the time we're living in now, everyone and their mother is going to deny the Bible. Because of the exclusivity. The fact that if you're going to accept the Bible, you must now accept the people that fit the prophecies of it. That the same poor people that are nothing, that have been downtrodden, that have lost everything, you come to find out these people are really the people of the book. And now you must deal with them in a certain manner according to the God of the book. See? They don't want to do this. They only want to use the Bible for their own turn and their own purpose. You can't do that. So first of all, on an elementary level, we're going to deal with the instructions of the Bible. And no matter who you are, what you're following, let's see if you can deny this. Let's deal with the instructions. Let's go to Timothy.
2 Timothy chapter 3, and I'll start at verse 13.
Go ahead.
Going down to 16. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse.
Go ahead.
Deceiving and being deceived.
So we're living in a time where there will be high deception. A person being deceived and deceiving others. Read.
14. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of.
But we must continue in the things we've learned and been assured of. See, I can be assured that in Deuteronomy 28, when it speaks of those slave ships, that the only people relate to that prophecy are the children of Israel, or the children of slaves that went to the shores of the Americas and around the world. No one can take me from that. I realize that there's no other history, no other book, no other information can actually break down our plight, our prophecies concerning slave ships, our fall. No other book. No other book. Usually, all the New Age books, they want you to forget the past and focus on what you can embody and what you can become now in this new age. You have evolved into something else. So they think that they move you towards the future in this oneness under Satan, under Lucifer. And by doing so, you forget your past. You forget your purpose. So you must be assured that the prophecies you've read in the Bible are correct. And they relate to you, that you are these people. So there's a purpose. Listen clearly.
The rest of verse 14. Knowing of whom thou hast learnt them.
Knowing from whom thou hast learnt them.
15. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures.
And from a child, guess what? And I'm speaking to mainly Christians right now. You grew up knowing those scriptures, quoting those psalms, quoting those prayers. But now you've gotten access to information on the internet or whatever the case is and have forgotten the Bible, which have got you through some tough times in your life, that have actually given you the answers. When the whole world rejected you, the Bible had the answers. You forget about that now. And we're going to get into that ever learning and never being able to come to the knowledge of the truth. And that happens when you begin to lose your foundation. So it doesn't matter how much knowledge you have and how much understanding you can obtain. If it leads you out of the Bible, it's nothing. It's nothing. Read.
And that from a child.
And from a child.
Thou hast known the Holy Scriptures.
Thou have known the Holy Scriptures.
Which are able to make thee wise unto salvation.
So it's the Bible that could make you wise to salvation. See? So it's one thing, I would say, grasping knowledge and getting a lot of information. It's another thing to get the knowledge of what salvation is. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about the salvations in the church. I don't know what they're dealing with there. But salvation is for people that's prophesied to one day rise. After going into captivity after captivity, the people of the Bible are near their salvation. They're near their rest. The children of Israel fell due to their sins, following the idols and the ways of the nations. And it was promised that one day a child would be born in this earth that would bring them back on the right path to receive the promises of Abraham. That's really the true purpose of the Bible, the rise of the same physical people that lead back to the bloodline of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's really the whole purpose of the Bible. But if they can make you think you're part of some Borg or some unit embodiment of all nations and all people and all ideologies, if they can make you believe you are part of that, you lose yourself. You lose your ancestors. You lose your purpose. And then you will begin to disrespect your purpose by putting down your book. Listen clearly. Read.
The rest of 15. Through faith, which is in Christ Yeshua.
Which is in Yeshua. Because if you get out of the book, the majority of people that grew up being able to quote scriptures, seeing the importance of Christ, understanding that this man was perfect in the spirit and following the Most High. These same people that once loved Christ, there's something they have in common, all of them. When they leave the Bible, they begin to loathe Christ. They begin to hate Christ for no reason. And when you look at Christ's character and read about him, there's nothing to hate if you're spiritual. There's nothing to hate. But the same people that begin to hate the Bible, they minimize Christ's value. And see, that was a plan from Satan himself to lead you into an antichrist doctrine and a new world, new age ideology. And guess what? They're moving everyone there. Whether you're Muslim, Christian, all these Christian pastors are now writing their own books and leading everyone into the new age. It's not even about the Bible. Even Christians now who claim they believe the Bible are claiming that, well, the Bible is not infallible. I believe in Christ and I'm a Christian, but I believe there's other ideologies that we should follow within ourselves because the Bible is old or the Bible has been tampered with through man. I hear Christians saying this now. That there are certain things don't apply because that was for back then. As if the Most High God have a clock. As if the clock, like time operates in heaven like on earth. Where the Most High is, there is no time where the Most High resides. Where he stands from the throne. There is no time. He created time. So they'll make you think, oh, that's old and passe. Leading you into the New Age movement. Let's go into these instructions. Read.
Verse 16. All scripture.
All scripture. Speaking of all scripture in the Bible. Not some mess somebody might have found in Tibet somewhere with some Asian monks or some Japhetic monks. Just because it's information in the old doesn't make it right. Read.
All scripture.
All scripture in the Bible. The Bible is only speaking of scriptures within the book. Scriptures of the Hebrews. Read.
Is given. By inspiration of the Most High.
Is given by inspiration of the Most High.
And is profitable for doctrine.
Is profitable for what?
For doctrine.
For doctrine.
For reproof.
First of all, there's a doctrine of the Bible. We're going to find out what that doctrine is. Okay? Just because you are Catholic, Muslim, Seventh-day Adventist, Jehovah's Witness, doesn't mean you have the right doctrine. If you're claiming that the Israelites are done away with and there's no more Israel and there's spiritual Israelites and all this mess that you made up, you're not following the doctrine. The doctrine tells us about the children of Israel, the rise of God's people, what happened to them. So you must have a doctrine concerning the people of the Bible. Read.
And is profitable for doctrine.
It's profitable for what?
For doctrine.
For doctrine.
For reproof.
For correction.
For correction.
Go ahead.
For instruction.
For instruction.
In righteousness.
In righteousness. Now, who can deny that? The Bibles give us instructions, do's and don'ts. That's clear in the Old Testament and backed up in the New Testament. The Ten Commandments. Who can say that's wrong? Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor, thou shalt not erect idols or bow down to an idol. Remember the Sabbath, keep it holy. Honor thy mother and father. Who can deny those principles? Mm-hmm. So, but there's something else going on though. Under the New Age, you can be what you want and still operate and be accepted in Satan's society. So if something in the Bible is actually against your lifestyle or against what you think, then you will begin to belittle it instead of accepting the correction. An example I can give, and I'm just going to use it as an example, not attacking someone that's struggling with sin. When you look at the act of homosexuality, now, you have some people who are, quote unquote, what they call gay, who struggle and know that it's wrong. They deal with dark moments knowing that they grew up in the church, grew up in the Bible, and understood the principles. But something happened growing up that turned them that way. Something happened. You understand? Something happened to them one way or the other, whether something was intrusive and someone dealt with them or something got on them in which they began to deal outside of the Bible. And what happened? Eventually, when they began to operate like that, they found pleasure in it. So they struggle back and forth, but now someone comes with the Bible, they don't want to accept anything concerning the Bible because now they must deal with the Bible that tells them to stop. They must deal with a Bible that tells them that, yeah, God love you. The Most High love you. He loves his creation, but you must repent from your sins and then be accepted. You must put the darkness away and come to the light. Some people don't want to do that. They know the Bible is correct, but instead of repenting for their sins, they'll start using science and all that's out there to lead them to the New Age and say, listen, you was born that way. You could be accepted no matter what you do. God loves you anyway. So they come with all these different variables to make you begin to believe that you were made this way, that the Bible could be tampered with, that the Bible is not true. And all these people that I'm speaking of, they're all in the same circle. The scientists, those that want to deal with the homosexual lifestyle, those that are dealing with alternative religions, they all have one thing in common. No Bible. They don't need something telling them they're wrong. They don't need something with instruction outside of their direction, opposed to them following the direction of the Most High. That's just an example. So the Bible is a book of instruction. There's nothing you're dealing with in life that you can't go into the Bible and read about. And then once you read about it, you have choices to make now. Do I continue to live like this, or should I change it because the God of this Bible says it's wrong? Let me just find a God or religion that can accept me. And that's what they do. They go be a Buddhist. They go be something else. See? Read.
Verse 17, that the man of God may be perfect.
Go ahead.
Thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
Go ahead.
I sit on that.
Thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So the Bible is a book of instruction. Now, first of all, you must understand how the purpose of the Bible. Okay, now let's go through a few purposes of the Bible. Before we deal with that, let's deal with how one should read the Bible. Because here's the mistake people have made, and I'm speaking to those in general out there who may have run into this video, may not be a Christian. And you, I'm speaking to you, you may have listened to what people were saying about the Bible and started repeating it without going into it yourself. To the point where you claim the Bible is tampered with, but yet you haven't read it. And I'm speaking to you all out there that may be like that. You don't understand the purpose of the Bible because you believe the purpose of the Bible was taught by the Christian church. You believe the purpose of the Bible was taught by the Catholic church or by the churches that are set up. And then you'll say, well, listen, how can the Bible be true when all these other religions have had the Bible for hundreds of years? And come to find out, none of them, they're still grasping for straws. They still don't have the answer. So who is you coming later and claiming that the Bible is true? Well, I can say emphatically that none of these religions, Seventh-day Adventists, Jehovah's Witnesses, none of them have ever taught the true doctrine of the Bible. Okay? They were set up to tamper with your minds so that one day you wouldn't believe in the book and then go into the New Age movement. That was their whole intent in the Bible. Not to give you the instructions to come to the Father, but to lead you to Satan. That was the point. And I hear so many excuses people have out there. Oh, I'm not going to deal with the Bible because the King James was a homosexual. King James' mother was this and he dealt with his mother. All these lies that cannot be corroborated, they're not founded. Even in the academy, we taught the whole history of King James. So where are these lies coming from? So they try to use the King James lie, not to go into it. Then they'll claim that it's plagiarized from somewhere, not to go into it. Why don't you just go into it? Why? Satan would rather put that wall in front of you because he know what happens if you go into it. And I'll tell you this, a person who don't believe in anything, put down your religion, put down whatever you're following, and just read the Bible from cover to cover at first if you want. And tell me you won't have a wealth of wisdom and understanding concerning the Most High. The Holy Spirit will teach you and give you understanding that nothing compares to this book. Nothing compares to this book. And some people feel that they have actually graduated from the Bible. They claim that, oh, yeah, I started off with the Bible, but now I'm dealing with this, that, and the other. But the Bible, then try to blame the Bible for you going there. The Bible never said go into it. The Bible says that you can't mate this book with any other. You can't mate the records of the Hebrews with any other. So don't claim that the Bible led you into Satanism. Let's go. Let's show.
First, I'm going to read Psalms 19 and 7.
Psalms 19 and 7. Read it.
The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul.
The law of the Lord is perfect, doing what?
Converting the soul.
So if you want to know what's right and get yourself together, look at what sins you're struggling with. Find out what sin is according to the Bible and go through repentance and leave off from that sin. The Bible has instructions on every sin, every weight that could be holding you down as far as sin is concerned or morality. So the law of the Bible is perfect. Who can deny it? And then some people say, well, that same information is over here too. Well, if it's the same information, why even go over there then? Mm-hmm. Why go there if it's the same information? It's not the same information. Or you would not have went there. See? Read.
This is 2 Timothy 2:15.
Let's get 2 Timothy 2:15. Make sure you write down these precepts. Go ahead.
Study.
Study.
To show thyself approved.
Study to show thyself approved.
Unto the Most High.
Unto the Most High. That means you must study the Bible. The doctrine contained in the Bible. That don't mean to study some mess outside of the Hebrews records. Study the book. There's enough in the Bible we haven't found out yet. And we want to go all into the world and Satan's religions and all this different archaeology and history that have nothing to do with our condition and our salvation. It means nothing. Study to show thyself approved. That means get the doctrine of the Bible down first. Not look at something and be like, well, it's something that I just can't agree with that. Well, guess what? The Most High is not in any position to morph himself into what you're going to agree with. Okay? Just because you don't agree with it doesn't make it wrong. Well, I don't know about that. You go into the law, Leviticus, which says, man shall not lie down with mankind as he lieth with a woman. I don't know about that. You go into the New Testament where it says there's lasciviousness and women laying with other women is wrong. I don't know. I don't know if that's politically correct. Like God done changed with the time or something. This is what Christians and the Christian doctrine have done. And because the world have been looking at them changing more as it goes along, they no longer believe in the Bible. Because those that represent the Bible, that are the authorities of the Bible, are saying that we shouldn't follow it. So they look at those examples and say, well, listen, let me find something else. Look what these guys are doing. It doesn't matter what they're doing. They're going to hell. You should go into it for the instructions for your own soul salvation. Read it again. Study to show thyself approved.
Unto the Most High.
You're doing this for the Most High. You're not doing it for man. You're not doing it to be accepted or to say I got higher knowledge to it than other people. You're doing it to show reverence to the God that led you to the truth, that led you to the Bible. You're studying to learn more about him, not to empower yourself. Read.
A workman that needeth not to be ashamed.
A workman who what?
That needeth not to be ashamed.
That needeth not to be ashamed. So when it says a workman who needeth not to be ashamed, you're working in these scriptures. And when you're dealing with scenarios and issues and debates, you won't be ashamed because you know your history. You know your book. You know the purpose of the Bible. Read.
Rightly dividing the word of truth.
Rightly dividing the word of truth. Rightly dividing the Bible. Not bringing out scriptures to move someone someplace else. That's not rightly dividing the word of truth. How can you get the truth from the Bible to be led someplace else? Doesn't work that way. If you don't believe in the Bible, and this is for those that don't believe in the Bible, don't go into it. Stay away from it. Why try to go in to try to coax someone into your ideology? If you don't believe in the Bible, come straight and bring the books you believe in and see if it stands. See if it tells us our history, how we fell, how we went into captivity, and how we will be saved. See if it breaks down all the empires our people went through, even America, and show what's going to happen to America in the world. Show me a book of prophecy that breaks down everything that's going down in the Middle East right now, exactly how the Most High said it in its proper order. That information don't exist. And guess what? Those that don't believe in the Bible, you don't even want to deal with those prophecies because it will lead you back to the only book that spoke of them. I don't hear anyone speaking of, oh man, that prophecy, the Quran said that prophecy would happen. Mm-hmm. Everyone know the Bible have exact prophecies and current events. The Bible is timeless. Let's go read.
Verse 16.
Go ahead.
But shun profane and vain babbling.
So that's why we shun profane and vain babbling. If it's not about the Most High and the purpose of this book, we shun it. We don't argue with it. We don't debate it. We move it to the side as foolishness. We totally shun it because it's outside of the purpose of why we were created and what's going on in the earth. It's a total distraction. So anything outside of the prophecies and what's going on in this book concerning the purpose of this book, concerning God's people, we are to shun it. We're not to entertain it. See, I go straight to the jugular when someone is coming with some mess. You show me your origin. You give me the book that you're coming from. Give me the purpose of this book. Don't try to shoot down the Bible. Okay? to leave someone hopeless without nothing. So their whole thing is to attack the Bible, knowing that they don't believe in the Bible. Don't attack the Bible. Show me what you're dealing with. You must have it if you didn't tore down the Bible. If what you have is greater than the prophecies, the purposes, Deuteronomy 28, Christ, and all the prophecies that's going on right now in chronological order, if what you have is bigger and better and more exact, why talk about the Bible? Show me what it is. If we don't have the truth, you bring it. And every platform we invite someone to bring it, they should start talking a bunch of mess and never reveal the origin of their mess. Because deep in their understanding, deep, they realize they done went off the path. Mm-hmm. But they put everything in it. They put all their eggs in that basket now, saying how great it was. And have too much pride to say, well, I may have slipped into something that have deceived me. So they're going to hold on to a lie instead of coming back to the God that born them. Read.
But shun profane and vain babbling.
But shun profane and what?
Vain babbling.
Vain babbling. Go ahead.
For they will increase unto more ungodliness.
Because they will increase unto more ungodliness, more madness. Read.
Verse 17. And their word will eat as doeth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred.
These are people that was in the truth Paul is speaking about. See? Because these people who once had some level of respect amongst other believers have word now. They have some level of authority. But then they start eating like canker amongst what? The ignorant, the unlearned. And they'll be like, well, yeah, I used to believe that, but God have shown me something greater. And I believe their God have showed them something, but not greater. All of them are leading to the apex of the triangle. All of them leading to Satan, the all-seeing eye. And the ties that bond with everyone I've spoken of that's with this Bible controversy, they all are against the Bible. And no matter what religion or ideology that they're under or what type of sexual behavior they're dealing with, it all leads to the apex of the all-seeing eye in the New Age movement. I don't care how good it sounds. Now, let's deal with how we know the Bible is correct real quick. We're not going to make this long and drawn out. First of all, we must know first purpose. What is the purpose of the Bible? Number one. Let's go to where it tells us that we should raise up the children of Jacob in Isaiah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Let's get that verse. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Here's the purpose of the Bible.
Isaiah chapter 49, verse 5.
Isaiah 49, 5 and 6. Here's, now, write it down. In order to deal with the Bible, one must know the purpose of the Bible. So if you're a Seventh-day Adventist, Holy Roller, no matter what you believe, Jehovah Witness, if you're not doing this, you don't believe in the truth concerning the Bible. You're not the authority if you're not willing to do this first. So what's the purpose of the Bible? Read.
Isaiah 49, verse 5.
49 and 5.
And now saith the Lord that formed me from the womb.
Now saith the Lord that formed me from the womb.
To be his servant.
To be his servant.
To bring Jacob again to him.
To do what?
To bring Jacob again to him.
So a servant of God, the purpose of a servant of God or someone that believe in the Bible is to do what?
To bring Jacob again to him.
It's your job to bring the children of Israel, which is Jacob. Jacob is the father of the children of Israel. So you must bring again the children of Israel back to the father. That's the purpose. To bring God's people back. God's people are destitute. They've been scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. They lost their identity. That's the purpose. I don't see no church, the Catholic Church, the Jesuits, none of them bringing God's people back to him as far as bloodline. They're claiming that there is no bloodline of Israel no more, that the Israelites are done away with. Read it again.
And now saith the Lord that formed me from the womb.
We were formed from the womb. We came out of our mother's belly to do what?
To be his servant.
To be his servant and to do?
To bring Jacob again to him.
To bring Jacob back to Ahia. Read.
Though Israel be not gathered.
Though Israel be not gathered. Why Israel is not gathered? Israel have been scattered due to a curse placed on their forefathers. So even though Israel is not gathered, read.
Yet shall I be glorious in the eyes of the Lord.
Yet I shall be glorious in the eyes of the Lord.
And my God shall be my strength.
And my God shall be my strength. So Israel is not gathered yet. So what is the purpose of a servant of the Most High? If you set up a church or an institution using the Bible, you should use the instructions to begin to gather Jacob back to the Father. So that's one great proof, circumstantial proof that all religions that are using the Bible are not using it correctly, because none of them are telling you that you are Jacob, that you are the children of God. Okay, so that's an example, because people would like to point to false religion and false Christianity to why they don't use the Bible. With a pull book. This is the reason you believe that. Because of the dark history of the popes have come out that they are Satanist. This is Rodrigo Bogier, the father of the white image that you see of Christ, Cesar Bogier. It was the Pope, the Vatican, the Jesuits that were behind the false doctrines while they were enslaving the children of Israel. And now that the Most High put his spirit on us to be awakened as the children of God, everyone now is pointing, well, if Jesus is not white, I mean, if Jesus is black and they lied on Jesus, then, you know, Jesus is a black man, then what else have they lied on? Then they start going into other things outside the Bible instead of realizing that the Bible never said Jesus was a white man. They did that. The Bible never said Peter and Paul and all of them were white. The Bible never said that. So now you're going to take your anger out on the Most High's book because of what they did, thinking that it's tampered with because the people who were in authority, who are in authority, they're Satanists right out. Well, anything they're related to, I don't want to deal with them. Well, they wasn't related to the book, brothers and sisters. If you know history, they are the Edomites. They are the Greeks. When we went into the Grecian captivity, okay, around the fourth century BC, do you know that they got all the scholars together to translate our Old Testament into Greek to try to understand us? Knowing that we were the children of God, they needed to know everything about us to control us, to psychologically control us and keep us in this condition. So they didn't get the book as the purpose of them claiming they were the people. They got the book to know more about us so that they can actually control us. All of the characters, the characteristics of God's people were written in the old scrolls. So they got it translated into Greek so that they can study us and control us. See that? So the Bible is still intact. The information is still intact. But it doesn't belong to them just because we fell as a people. The book belongs to us. We must come back to the book. Read that part again.
Verse 6. And he said, it is a light thing.
It is a light thing.
That thou shouldest be my servant.
That thou shalt be my servant.
To raise up the tribes of Jacob.
To raise up the tribe of Jacob.
And to restore the preserved of Israel.
So this is what happened. The children of Israel fell. You know the story. Matter of fact, those who might not have listened to our past videos, I'm just going to just quantify it to show you why we must focus on gathering God's people again. Who is Jacob? Let's go to Deuteronomy 32 and 21 real quick. Deuteronomy 32 and 21, read it.
Deuteronomy 32, verse 21.
Go ahead.
They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not the Most High.
We have moved the Most High to jealousy. That's what our forefathers did in the past. We put up other gods for him. Read.
They have provoked me to anger with their vanities.
Go ahead.
And I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people.
So because our forefathers moved our God to jealousy by following rocks and following other ideologies and ideas of the nations, since we began to follow other gods, the Most High did what?
I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people.
Since we put up a no God for him, he in turn put up a no people for us. Now other people in the earth would be reverenced as royalty, as the people of God, instead of us. That's not the white man's fault. We did that. So that's why we're on the bottom and every other nation is held high and is esteemed over us. Read.
I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation.
And now the Most High got fools running things. By our choice. We were running everything. But since we wanted to follow the ways of the nations, and a lot of you are falling to that today, the Most High say, well, I'm going to put you under them and see how you fare now. That's how we got into this condition. But there was a stipulation that through blood, a bloodline would come into the earth to be sacrificed, because in the Israel's law, there's an atonement for blood, with blood. The atonement happened with Christ. So that's where the salvation leads in that. Now the Christian church then took that someplace that it don't belong. Okay? They don't understand what salvation is, because the instructions of the Bible is to do what? To raise again the children of Jacob. So what happened? We began to follow all the gods. Deuteronomy 28 said that we would go into captivity, go into slave ships because of our disobedience. And now we're here. Now we're in the land of our oppressors. The foolish nations ruling over us while we're on the bottom. And now we're still looking to the foolish nations to give us answers concerning our destiny. We're still looking at the same oppressors' information and their science and their archaeology to teach us about ourselves. Now, Deuteronomy 28 tells us that we would go into captivity. That happened, right? Where was that prophesied? The Bible. What other book chronologically gives all the captivities we've been under thousands of years before it happened, including the American captivity? The prophecies itself should tell you the Bible is a higher book, a greater spiritual book than any other knowledge on earth. Let's go to Romans, where it tells us, what if some did not believe?
Romans 3 and 3.
Romans 3 and 3.
For what if some that did not believe?
Let's go before that.
Verse 1.
Yes.
Romans 3 and 1.
Go ahead.
What advantage then have the Jew?
What advantage is it me knowing that I'm an Israelite? That me knowing that I'm from the children of God or the people of the Bible? Read.
Or what profit is there of circumcision?
What profit is there of circumcision? Circumcision was a law given to the clean people, the people with law. Read.
Much every way.
So according to the New Testament, there is an advantage of one being a Jew or an Israelite. There is an advantage. What is the advantage?
Chiefly. Because that unto them. Were committed the oracles of God.
Unto these particular people, this bloodline was committed the oracles of God. The oracles of God is contained in the Bible. The book. The Bible was given to us. It was our book. The records of our fathers. Read.
For what if some did not believe?
Now then, the question is, so what if some did not believe? Oh, I don't believe the Bible like some of you out there. Well, the Bible is tampered with. Oh, I come to find out that the Bible is a devil's book. Or whatever mess you want to bring out. For what if some did not believe?
Shall their unbelief make the faith of the Most High without effect?
Just because you don't believe, does that mean the Most High is not going to do everything he said he would do in the oracles of God? Does that make the prophecies of God without effect? Just because you don't believe, did your unbelief stop Deuteronomy 28 from happening? Did your belief stop all the wars in the Middle East that are happening in chronological order according to the prophets in the Bible? To show you, your unbelief means nothing. Because the will of God that's contained in this Bible is still going. It's happening before your eyes. So while you're ignoring the book, you're also ignoring the times we're in concerning what will happen to you if you're not watching as well as praying in this book. So what if you don't believe? Shall your unbelief make the faith of God without effect? You think the Most High is going to stop time just so that he can deal with you? You're just going to get rolled over. And you're going to find that you've been led off of the path. And I don't care what I'm dealing with. I will never put down the Bible. No other book have ever shown me our true purpose, my true purpose, and the understanding of our people and why we're in this condition. When you bring that information, I'll be open to hear it. Okay? It's the Bible that have educated us concerning the Most High. We didn't have this information in the Christian church. We didn't have this information going through the Theologian Seminary College. It was not until we walked away from that mess that the Most High had to show through. Because the church is not bringing again Jacob to the Father. They're not dealing with the purpose of the Bible. When you bring up Jacob, they'd be like, oh, we're spiritual Israelites. What is that? Read.
God forbid.
So what if some did not believe? Shall you make the faith of God without effect because you don't believe? God forbid. The world will go on. We will continue. All the prophecies will happen. But I'll tell you what, some people that out there that are denying the Bible didn't have faith in the truth from the beginning. You didn't have foundation in the truth, in the Bible. Your foundation laid somewhere else. And maybe things didn't happen in the time you thought they would happen. And through that little space, you started to believe something else. A deception. Read.
Yea.
Yea.
Let God be true.
Let who be true?
Let God be true.
Let the Most High be true and what?
But every man a liar.
Any book that a man going to bring out that's outside of the prophecies of the oracles, which is the Bible, is a lie. Every man a liar. So what is the Most High talking about? Books that are made by man that people go into to say, well, I don't know about the Bible. Well, what about the man you're learning from that actually put together the book you believe in? But you believe in that. What make that man greater than the prophets? Greater than Christ? We had a guy on the show the other day who didn't believe in the Bible and started quoting some man's book that everyone should look into. What make him greater than Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel? He didn't prophesy all four empires God's people would go into, including the Greeks and Roman Empire. He didn't prophesy the American captivity our people went into. So what makes him so great that we have to put down the Bible and follow this Negro who's a child of slaves in America? Where is his authority? But people will say, well, listen, he's a man. Well, these are just men. No, that man you're reading about did not prophesy the children of Israel falling and how they would come back as a people. This book is about the liberation of the poor, God's people. It's the answer to all our ills. What you got?
Psalms 116 and 11.
Read.
I said in my haste, all men are liars.
All men are what?
All men are liars.
Now why does it say all men are liars? Because a man with his own ideology can write anything he wants. But the book is inspired by the Most High. The Bible is inspired by the Most High. Okay, it's not their own ideas. When you read the prophets, the teachers in the Bible, they all had the same instructions concerning the Most High in relation to his people. No variation. Isaiah didn't just wing it and write what he wanted to write. Jeremiah didn't just wake up and write what he wanted to write. The Bible mesh and it all correlates with each other in a perfect combination. Now, I wanted to go into this because this is a segue into what we're going to be dealing with when it comes to how to break down the book. Okay? Most people are going into other places and going all over the place because why? They don't have teachers. They don't understand what they must be looking at when it comes to beginning in the Bible. And that's what throws them off. They're not getting fed. So they find something that can relate to their character or relate to what they feel they should be getting. So we're going to show you something here. Before we go there, dealing with the purpose of the Bible, I wanted to deal with Christ real quick to show you how the New Testament should be related to the Old Testament. I showed you that Israel fell as a nation. Now we're going into, let's go there. Let's go to Matthew 1 and 21. Matthew 10, 5 and 6. Matthew 15 and 24.
Matthew 1, 21.
Now, the Old Testament, we fell as a people, right? Before you get that, get Hosea 8 and 11. We're going to go right through these precepts. Let me know in 10 minutes. Let's go.
Hosea 8 and 11.
Hosea 8 and 11, read.
Because Ephraim have made many altars.
No, Hosea 9 and 11.
Hosea 9 and 11. As for Ephraim, their glory shall not 17.
9 and 17. That's it.
Hosea 9 and 17.
Hosea 9 and 17.
My God will cast them away.
My God will cast them away.
Because they did not hearken unto him.
So the people of the Old Testament, Israel fell because God did not, they did not hearken to the God of the Bible. They didn't want to follow the laws. They begin to follow the other nations, the Gentiles. Read.
And they shall be wanderers among the nations.
So because Israel, who was once a nation, didn't follow the God of the Bible, they became wanderers. How did they become wanderers? Let's go to Hosea 8 and 11. Let's get that.
Hosea 8, 8.
Yeah, 8 and 8.
Hosea 8 and 8.
Go ahead.
Israel is swallowed up.
Israel is now swallowed up. No one knows who Israel is.
Now shall they be among the Gentiles.
Now they shall be among the where?
The Gentiles.
Now Israel is going to be scattered amongst the Gentiles.
As a vessel wherein is no pleasure.
And they will get no pleasure or rest being amongst the Gentiles. See? And that's why our people have no understanding of themselves, because they have, our people have been absorbed into the Gentile ideologies and the Gentile mindset. Matter of fact, the children of God believe they're Gentiles now. They're not relating to themselves to the people of the book. And that's a big issue of why our people won't come back to the Bible. Why? Or won't relate ourselves to the Bible, not knowing that the prophecies belong to them. Now, where do Christ come in? Where do salvation come in? Let's go.
Matthew 1 and 21.
This is Christ.
And she shall bring forth a son.
So now Israel fell. It was prophesied that a root of Jesse would come out of a dry ground. Read it.
And she shall bring forth a son.
That she is Mary.
And thou shalt call his name Yeshaya.
Thou shalt call his name. It says Jesus in your book, but we know in Hebrew it's Yeshaya.
For he shall save his people from their sins.
So Christ would one day come into the earth to save who?
His people.
What people?
His people.
Who?
His people.
His people, the same people that were scattered amongst Gentiles.
From their sins.
From their sins. See? So Christ would become that sacrifice so that the Holy Spirit can go throughout the earth to one day gather Israel back together. That's the true purpose of the Bible, brothers and sisters. Any ideology that's teaching that Christ came for any other purpose is a false ideology. He came to gather the people who were scattered. What people were scattered throughout the earth that served and built all these empires? The children of God. And that's what all the religions are ignoring. Even in America, they got the all-seeing eye, the pyramid on their money, knowing that the same people that built Egypt built America. The children of God. But they'll never tell you that. Let's get some more. Let's get Matthew 10, 5, and 6.
Matthew 10, 5, and 6.
Now let's get Matthew 15 and 24 first.
St. Matthew 15, verse 24.
Go ahead.
Matthew 15, 24.
Go ahead.
But he answered and said, I am not sent.
I am not sent.
But. Unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
So it says that Israel is, the Christ was not sent but unto who?
The lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Christ was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Why? Because Israel needed a sacrifice to come back to the Father. Christ was that road back. And that's the connection between the Old and New Testament. They work in combination. They work together in correlation. Not one against the other or one controversy against another within the Bible. No. The Old Testament is the beginning of man, the rise of God's people, and the fall of God's people. The New Testament is the sacrifice for God's people to one day come back and the rise again of God's people. That's the true story. The problem is the slaves is not getting that story because the slaves are being taught by the Gentiles. Those that fear that the slaves will one day rise. That they would realize they're the children of God and come back and cleave to their God. And once that happened, all the gods of the nations will fall. That's what they fear. So they scatter us in all these different ideologies. And then put stories out there to make you hate yourself. By beginning to filter out information so that you can begin to hate or walk away from the Bible. That's hating yourself, because the Bible is you. That's your mother. Sarah is your mother. Abraham is your father. So you're putting down yourself to seek back to the Gentiles. And that's what the Gentiles, that's what the nations love. Why? Because now you're under their God. Lucifer, Satan, Zeus, Osiris. You can name them whatever you want to name them. Amen. Whatever you want to name them. It leads everyone back to the all-seeing eye. The Bible is our only refuge. More purpose. Matthew 15 and 24. Read it.
Matthew 15, 24.
Read.
But he answered and said.
This is what Christ said.
I am not sent.
I am not sent.
But. Unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Christ was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. You are the lost sheep. Going from hill to mountain trying to find yourself. Now you have found the Bible and you feel you need something else. Now you have found the truth of yourself. Contained in the Bible, and now you think or want something else. When guess what? There's so much wealth of information in the Bible that you can study it over and over and over and over again and never get the same information because the Bible is manifold. No one can perfect their understanding concerning the Bible because there's so much information in it. There's no other place to go. The Bible is the truth. You understand? And I'm going into this to show you that a lot of people now are going into this apostate mindset in which they're looking to leave the Bible or question the Bible without going into it and understanding it. The Bible was put here so that Jacob can one day stand as a people and look the enemies in the eyes, the Gentiles in the eyes and say, you know what? Your conspiracy didn't work. Through all the lies, the people of the Bible, the children of Israel, is back. And we're going to get what's ours. We renounce your gods. We renounce your idols. We renounce the governments of the world. And we are now preparing for our government. Now that's the true spirit. That's the doctrine of the Bible. You understand? So I wanted to touch on the controversy of the Bible. We have more. Christ says he was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, right? Let's get Luke 1 and 68. Go ahead.
St. Luke 1 and 68.
Now we're going to go into something elementary, because next week we're going to go into how to read the Bible and understand it. How to read the Bible so that no one can deceive you by bringing you some precepts when you don't even know the purpose of the Bible, the true intent of the Bible, how to actually go into it, and to be able to identify deceivers. Any person that tell me that they don't believe in the Bible, but yet go into the Bible to try to prove their point, they're the devil. They're deceivers. You can't go into the Bible to lead someone out of the Bible. Okay? If you're dealing with something outside the Bible, put down the Bible and show me what you got. So brothers and sisters, if someone try to take you outside the Bible and try to use the Bible as the platform to do so, look them straight in the eyes and say, you are a deceiver. Because if you had the truth, you would just bring me the truth. You don't have to claim that my Bible corroborates your mess. And I'm going to tell you, they prey on the unlearned. So you have to be careful. The Bible will never guide you into something else. Read it.
Luke 1 and 68.
Go ahead.
Blessed be the Lord God of Israel.
Blessed be the Lord God of what?
Of Israel.
Not the Lord God of Asia. Not the Lord God of any other place but Israel. Read.
For he hath visited and redeemed his people.
For he of what?
For he hath visited
and redeemed. For he hath visited
and redeemed.
And redeemed
his people.
And none of the churches are telling you who his people are. This whole Bible is about the fall and rise of the slaves, the poor, the meek, those that are suffering, those that are actually at the bottom of the totem pole, those that have been preyed upon by the New World Order's government. Look at the Filipinos, look at the people in Mexico, look at the poor in America, look at the poor in Africa. These are the scattered tribes of Israel. And Christianity have been the deception that they have used, using Christ's name as a cloak to prey on us, to have missionaries to kill us. And it wasn't until the Holy Spirit came that enlightened us to our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the people in the Bible, so that we can relate ourselves to our fathers, to the book. And if we don't defend the book, who will? They got our people, children of slaves, people with nothing, claiming the Bible is tampered with. The Bible is not nothing. Well, the Bible is here to liberate you, to point you back to the God that put us in this condition based on our disobedience. And I'm going to say this. For those who was once Christians and found out that Christianity was wrong, but still believed in the Bible and the fact that we were the children of Israel. If you don't believe in the Bible, after learning you were the children of Israel, the children of God, if you now don't believe in the Bible, you would have been better off staying asleep in Christianity. At least you had the Bible. At least you had a shot. When you walk away from the Bible, if you walk away from Christ, you are condemned. Last scripture, and next week we're going to go into how to break down the book. First, I wanted to deal with the Bible controversy. There's more I wanted to go into, but I don't have time right now. But next week, we're going to go into how to break down the book. How you can actually have a foundation in which no one can ever take you out of the Bible again or try to deceive you with their information. We're going to show you how to use the Bible to ward off these demons that have inhabited these people that would move you outside of the book. That's what we're going through next week. We're going to the bottom, we're going to the base information to keep the foundation of the book intact. That's where we are. And will this year a challenge to anyone? We know that non-believers watch this too. We're going to open this up. We have a blog talk show every Wednesday. If there's someone out there anywhere that can prove the Bible is wrong, and we'll give you an open invitation on the show to prove to us that the Bible is wrong, send an email, gathering@1, that's the number one, @AOL.com, and say, I'm going to come and prove the Bible is wrong. If you can prove the Bible is wrong, then we will open up the dialogue so that you can actually bring us to the knowledge of the truth. And if you have truth and the Bible is wrong, we'll follow it. Mm-hmm. But you better come with it. Okay? Don't come with some mess and just talk. You need to bring some proof, some understanding. Okay? We're not somebody, some guys who just rolled out of bed and began to read the Bible. So these are the people you run into in the street who haven't read anything that make you believe you bring in something. You have to bring circumstantial proof of our condition, how we got in this condition, who we were in the past, before slavery, before Africa. You have to bring it all to us and then prove to us the Bible is wrong. And then give us the answer out of this according to whatever information you're bringing. And if you're talking with no circumstantial proof, with no books, no information, then that conversation will end very quickly. We're not letting anyone come on a show just to talk. You're going to bring proof, or we're going to shun profane babbling. Okay? That means we'll bless you, say we bless you, then we hang up on you, and we're going to teach the people. If you don't bring the truth. Read, last scripture. Read it again.
St. Luke 1 and 68. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel.
Blessed be the Lord God of Israel that did what?
For he have visited and redeemed his people.
He have visited and redeemed his people. And who are God's people? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. The people that have been scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. In Jamaica. In Hawaii. In the Fiji Islands. In Australia. They're suffering in Australia. The brothers and sisters suffering there. All over the earth. The brothers and sisters who are suffering in England. The poor, who the children of slaves, we are the children of God and we're on the rise. We must defend our book. Without our book, we are nothing. We are nothing. So I'm going to issue this challenge to anyone who believes that the Bible is wrong. You come on to the show and prove the Bible is wrong. If the Bible is wrong, we'll follow your truth. If it's not, you in turn must listen, because the Most High Word is coming out of this book to instruct you back to him. Isaiah 34 and 16. Let's read that last.
Isaiah 34 and 16. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord. And read.
Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read, which is the Bible. The Bible wouldn't be moving you to another book. If it's saying the book of the Lord, it means the Lord of the Bible, not some other God outside of the Bible. Seek ye out of the book of the Most High God, Ahia, and read. Read.
No one of these shall fail.
None of the prophecies in the Bible have failed, has they? Give me a prophecy that have failed out of the Bible. Everything that said, even the mark of the beast with the RFID chip was prophesied from John on the Isle of Patmos. He was on the island by himself. And now the technology is in this earth today. Have that failed? None of these shall fail in what?
None shall want her mate.
And you cannot mate the book with any other book. The Bible stands alone. You cannot mate the Bible with the Gita, the Book of the Dead, the Egyptian Book of the Dead, or any other book you have out there. If it's not Israel, it's in the trash. If it's not the Hebrew records, it's in the trash. Because all nations, according to Isaiah 83, have conspired to hide the fact that we are the people. And they said, come and let us deal wisely with them, that the name of Israel be no more in remembrance. And what people are at the pinnacle of this deception? Those people who have stolen Palestine, claiming to be us, claiming to be God's people. We're going to go there too. How can they push that garbage in Hollywood? How can they push atheist teachings and all that and claim to be God's people? We're going to deal with them too. Read it again.
Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read.
Read your Bible, brothers and sisters. Read.
No one of these shall fail.
Because none of the prophecies have ever failed, and the future prophecies are to come. And I'm going to go into that next week according to a few prophecies, like the Euphrates River drying up like the Most High said it would. Read.
none shall want her mate.
And you can't mate the book, the Bible, with any other record outside of Hebrew records. You can't bring no Asian book somewhere from Tibet. You can't bring a Buddhist temple's ideology or metaphors within God's book. Read.
For my mouth it have commanded.
Because the Bible is the mouth of God. It's the mouth of the Most High. Read.
And his spirit it have gathered them.
And it's going to be the spirit of this book that will gather the children of Israel back to the Father. The Bible is the way. With that, I'm going to say shalom. Hope I dealt to some degree with the Bible controversy, but we're going to do this in stages. We're going to show you how to actually go into the Bible and build a foundation and belief structure where no one can come to you with some mess and pull you out. And we'll do that next Sabbath. With that, I'm going to say shalom.
Shalom.